Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. We appreciate the visitors. May the good Lord bless you. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We hope you can do it now. We're coming up, that we can be an inspiration to everyone. And you in the radio listening audience, if you know a shut-in friend, and they're not listening to the Northside Baptist Church Hour, get on the phone, give them a ring, and tell them to tune in and get this hour coming up. I'm sure they'd enjoy it. Brother Tony Crawford, my associate, has a good musical program lined up for us, and we'd be preaching to you what thus saith the Lord God. And you'd be doing them a favor and us as well if you'll call them and have them to tune in and get this hour coming up. Tape number 238. You can have this tape for a gift of $3. And the $3 is used to help defray our radio expense. And write in and get it. Also, when you write in, request our list. We'll send you a list of over 230 of our cassette tape. We won't take time to mention them by name or title this morning, but you can write in and get a list and select the ones you want by number, by title. At the same time, you can write in and get our brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour for March of next year, when we plan to go to Israel for 8 days and Geneva, Switzerland for 2 days. So write in and pray for us and stand by this home mission work, and we appreciate it so very much. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. Now, many of you in the radio listening audience enjoyed this broadcast. Some of our people were down in Valdosta, Georgia, last Sunday and picked it up in Valdosta. That's a long way off. So we have a good coverage, and we thank God for this open door. So you pray for us and stand by this home mission work. Take your Bible and turn to the book of Judges, chapter 16, page 307 is where I'm reading from in my Bible today. While you turn there, let me invite you to come back and be with us this evening at 6. Now, if you enjoyed the singing this morning, you'll most certainly enjoy it this evening. I will preach to you what thus saith the Lord God. So you be here at 6 and get in on the evening service. Then on Wednesday nights, we have our Bible study and prayer meeting, and we're making a study of the book of Acts on Wednesday nights. Be delighted to have you in the service. Bring your Bible. Come right along. You don't have to dress up. In fact, I had the privilege of putting off my coat and my tie last Wednesday night. And so you just come right on and be with us in the Wednesday evening service, and we appreciate it so very much. Now today, I'm going to speak on the subject, the seven locks of Sampson's hair. The seven locks of Sampson's hair. I want you in the radio listen audience to write in and get this tape. Be a blessing to you. Also, we'd like to get the tape number 216 on the tongues and the charismatic movement. You need that tape very much in these days. And I hope you write in and get it. Now, Sampson here became one of the judges in Israel. And the Philistines had dominated Israel and given them a hard time. And Sampson came into power and had great conflict with the Philistines. And Sampson, of course, became very weak indeed in regard to some things of the flesh. And this woman, Delilah, here talked him into giving away his secret of his power. Now, Sampson was a Nazarite. From his mother's womb, that meant he couldn't cut his hair, he couldn't drink wine, and had to live a separated life. He had long hair. Now, the reason that the Nazarite had to wear that long hair is because it's a reproach unto man to wear long hair, and he had to bear the reproach for the cause of God in that respect, and he couldn't let his hair be cut off. The old lady Delilah just kept worrying him about the power of his, the secret of his power, why he was so strong, and he knew it was in his hair. And finally he gave in and told her if she would cut off the seven locks of his hair,
He'd be as weak as other men. Now look at verse 18 of Judges chapter 16. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the Lord of the Philistines, saying, "Come up this once, for he has showed me all of his heart." Then the Lord of the Philistines came up unto her and brought money in their hand. And she made him sleep upon her knees. And she called for a man, and she caused him to shave off the 7 locks of his head. And she began to afflict him, and his strength went from him. And she said to the Philistines, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson. And he awoke out of his sleep and said, "I will go out as other times before and shake myself." And he wist not the Lord was departed from him. But the Philistines took him and put out his eyes and brought him down to Gezer and bound him with fetters of brass. And he did grind in the prison house. And 2 Peter chapter 1, because we'll be referring to the scripture, and it's page 1317 in the original Scofield Reference Bible, beginning with verse 4. "Whereby given us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, and beside this given all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that liketh these things is blind." Now that's what happened to Samson. He lost these traits and he became physically blind. His eyes were put out and he had to grind in the grinding meal there, as we'll say more about that later. "But he that liketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and has forgotten that he was purged from his old sins." Now it seems that Samson had forgotten that he was a Nazarite and he should live separated unto God. And he lost these things that are mentioned here in 2 Peter 1. And he became a blind man. And he was blinding and binding and grinding at the devil's gristmill. Now that's exactly what the devil will do for you. You cut the 7 locks of your hair off and you'll lose these things I mentioned here. In 2 Peter chapter 1, you'll find yourself blinded, grinding, binding in the devil's gristmill. And it'll seem that you have forgotten that back yonder somewhere God saved your soul, pardoned you from your sins, and wrote your name in heaven. Now the name Samson means sunny. That's the meaning of that name, sunny. And the Bible tells us in Psalms chapter 19, verse 5, that the sun, like a bridegroom coming out on a flight, and as a strong one, referring to the sun. So Samson means sunny, referring to the sun as something very strong. He was a strong man. But we'll have to give credit to his mother where credit is due, because she believed what the angel told her when she was informed that she'd give birth to a son. In Judges chapter 13, verse 3, the angel of the Lord appeared unto the woman and said unto her, "Behold, thou art barren, and bearest not, but thou shalt conceive and bear a son." Then the woman came and told her husband. Now Samson's mother had a message from heaven sent to her by an angel that she would give birth to a son. This son would be the strong man Samson, of course, and he would be a judge in Israel for many years. He was very, very strong physically, as we see in the message, as long as he had the 7 locks of his hair. But when he lay his head in old Delilah's lap and she had his hair cut off, he lost his power. Now, the second thing about this I want you to notice is that Samson was a gift from God. In Judges chapter 13 and verse 3, "And the angel of the Lord appeared unto the woman and said unto her, Behold, thou art barren and bearest not, but thou shalt conceive and bear a son." This man Samson, this strong man physically and even spiritually at times, there was a gift from God Almighty to this man and woman. They had no children, and God gave them the Son. The Bible says in John chapter 3 and verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now salvation is a gift from God. God's Son is a gift to this world, and salvation is a gift from God. In Ephesians chapter 2 verses 6 or 8, by faith are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Now God gave his Son, and then salvation is given unto us. Like Sampson was a gift to his parents, Jesus Christ is a gift to this lost and dying world, and salvation is a gift given to everyone that receive it by faith in Christ. You need to remember that, not of works, lest any man should boast. All cults today are based upon human efforts, but salvation is of the Lord. You must remember that. We're living in perilous times, momentous days. We're living in an evil time when crime is filling the land. Every day you pick up your paper, you look at the news, you see where young people are killed, drinking, driving, on dope, committing murder. And you've never seen a time like this. Now you have the ACLU, the America's Cranky Lunatic Union, that's trying to take out of jail all the criminals they can and trying to save all the people on death row from going to the electric chair. And they're working feverishly because they're working against God and against the Bible and against true Americanism. Now these are appeal court judges that's letting these men off and letting them free from being put to death and letting them out of prison. They're working with Satan. They're working against the Bible. They're a group of liberals like the Three Stooges that overturned the conviction of the Allday family. They're filling this land with criminals, and they want to let these prisoners out of prison because that is their bread and butter. And many of these crooked judges and crooked lawyers, that's the way they get their money. And they love that criminal. If they didn't have lawbreakers, then of course they couldn't fill their coffers, and they're for the criminal. They don't care one thing, not one thing, about the family that suffers from the hand of a criminal. A man could come in and rape your family and murder your family, and these crooked appeal court judges and ACLU members, America's Cranky Lunatic Union, or Crime Loving Union, or whatever it stands for, they could care less. They don't care a thing in the world about how much you suffer. Those three judges that overturned the conviction of the Allday family, they're just as guilty if they'd have gone and dug up those bodies and spit in their face and walked in the homes and spit in the face of their loved ones. Amen. Just as guilty if they'd have done that. I have no more respect for them than I have for these hardened criminals that committed that murder, and you're welcome. And if you don't like it, you can lump it, leave it, or whatever you want to do. That's my conviction anyway. Now the land is being filled with criminals today, and we need some politicians to stand up and try to do something about this business and see if we can't do what God said in this book. Now you listen to me. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 9 and verse 6, in Exodus chapter 21 and verse 12, and many other places in the Bible, the Bible said that person that commits cold-blooded murder, he's to be punished. And God said, I'll tell you exactly how to punish him. God said, you punish him by putting him to death. That's God's punishment. That's his punishment. And if we don't do that, we're not abiding according to the Bible. Now, you can argue against capital punishment. You can argue against the death penalty all you please. You can show your ignorance if you want to. But the Word of God plainly said what to do. Amen. And we're moaning and groaning today about our prisons being overcrowded. And if we do what God said in this book, that would solve the situation. If you clean off death row and put those people to death like God said they should be put to death, and every time a person commits cold-blooded murder, put him to death right away. And then you'd have more room in prison for those who are sent there for other causes. And many of these criminals will be afraid to commit a death or kill someone because they know it'll happen to them. Now, the first person knows today you're not going to punish criminals is that criminal. He knows that. He can go out and kill a dozen people. It doesn't matter. Down here in Florida, they stayed the execution of two men, and these two men together had killed more than 70 people. They had murdered more than 70 people, and the liberal crime-loving appeal courts, one in Georgia, one in Florida, stayed the execution because that was the 10th anniversary of the ruling of the Supreme Court on the matter of capital punishment, and they hate capital punishment. They're against capital punishment. That's why they stall, and that's why they extend of putting to death these criminals, because they hate capital punishment. That's their lifeline. That's why they make their money. That's why they love criminals, and that's why they care nothing about the victims of those that have to suffer. Now, that's not my message, but I felt led to bring that in, whether you like it or not. Now, this man, Sampson, he was a gift from God, and God Almighty gave his son as a gift. Number three, he was to be separated unto God. Sampson was to be a separated man. The Bible says in chapter 13, verses 4 and 5, that he was to be separated. No razor should come upon his head. He should not drink strong drink. I just heard on the news this morning where two young girls had left a couple of bars where they'd been drinking and driving too fast, evidently lost control of the car, killed one. The other's in serious condition, just teenage girls. That's happening all over this nation, not only in Athens, but all over this nation. This Bible teaches total abstainers. This Bible tells us that you're not to drink wine and strong drinks. The Bible says don't do it. And our young people are slaughtering themselves on the highways today, getting in automobiles, driving down the highway at breakneck speed, not realizing they're flirting with their own lives. Alcoholic beverages and driving doesn't go together. Beloved, if you're going to drive, don't drink. Don't drink, because if you drink and drive and kill somebody, you're guilty of killing an innocent person, and God will hold you responsible. And so God said, be separated. In Numbers chapter 6 and verse 5, the Bible said he was a Nazarite. Separated, not to drink strong drink, not to eat certain types of food, and not to cut his hair that it might be a reproach. And God told him what to do. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17, wherefore come out from them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. And he said, I will receive you. You find that in the scriptures in 2 Corinthians 6:17. Come out and be ye separate. Now God commands in the Bible that his people be a different people. This man Samson here that lost the 7 locks of his hair became entangled into the world and there lost his power. God says be separated from the world. He was blessed of the Lord. In Judges chapter 13 verses 24 and 25. The woman bare a son, called his name Samson, and the child grew, and the Lord blessed him, and the Spirit of the Lord began to move him in times in the camp of Dan between Zorah and Eshtaol. This man was blessed of the Lord. He had God's blessings upon him. God said, be separated. He did not abide by that command and became involved in worldly things, and there he was stripped of his joy and his power and his prestige, because he would not live separated. God expects his people to be a separated, different type people from the people of this world. Number five, he was moved by the Spirit to do amazing exploits. You find in Judges chapter 13 and verse 25, and the Spirit of the Lord began to move him at times. This man Samson had great physical power. He had great spiritual power. He had good wisdom at many times. And he began to move under the Spirit of God. One day, he was going down to visit the Philistine woman, and there a lion came out. A lion in the Bible is a type of the devil. The Bible said the devil goeth about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And here comes this lion. This man, Samson, had the Spirit of God upon him, and he caught that lion and tore him asunder and threw his carcass aside. Now, unless you have the Spirit of God upon you, unless you're strong with the fullness of God's Spirit, many times you go to meet a lion on life's journey. Are you able to cope with that lion? If you're filled with God's Spirit, you can. If not, then he might overcome you in many ways. And so they killed a lion. The Bible says in Judges chapter 14, verses 5 and 6, he rid him as if he was a little kid, and they went on his way. Later he came back by, and he noticed a swarm of bees. had swarmed on the inside of the carcass of that lion and had made some honey. Now Samson goes over and gets him a big chunk of that honey. Now after you kill your lion, you can get your honey. But unless you kill your lion, you may be deprived of your honey. Would you like to have some good spiritual honey? Be sure you can get the lion. Now he didn't brag about it. He didn't tell anybody he'd killed that lion. If that had been a lot of people I know, they'd have got up on the housetop and crowed out loud and said, you know, I just killed a lion. But not Samson. Samson kept it to himself. He didn't tell anyone. He didn't brag about it. He slew the lion and he didn't brag about it. In chapter 14 and verse 6, but he told not his father, his mother what he had done. And then when he got him a big chunk of honey, he thought about his mother and daddy. He wanted them to have some of that good honey. And he carries them a chunk of that honey. Now, we as God's people need to be concerned about others. If we have the good things of God, let's tell others about it. If we have a good church home, let's invite others to it. If we enjoy the blessings of God, let's tell others how they can enjoy the blessings of God. So Samson carried them some good honey. The Bible tells in chapter 14, verse 8 and 9, he carried it home with him and gave it to his mother and daddy, chapter 14. He came to his father and mother and gave them, and they did eat. So he enjoyed the honey after the conquering of the lion. Now, if you want to enjoy spiritual blessings, just overcome the enemy at certain times. Don't be like the little boy. His mother told him to stay out of the cookie jar. He said, Mama, that thing just tempts me. She said, stay out of that cookie jar, son. And he said, well, the devil causes me to get in that cookie jar. She said, you tell Satan to get thee behind you and you stay out of that cookie jar. One day she came in, he had his hand full of cookies, and she said, son, didn't I tell you whenever you were tempted just to say, get thee behind me, Satan? He said, yes, Mama, that's what it did. And so he got behind me and shoved me right into that cookie jar. Well, now many times you feel like the devil will shove you into the cookie jar, but really, he can't do that unless you allow him to do so. Get thee behind me, Satan. Then we find this man, Samson, had great power to the extent he took a jawbone of an ass, and there he killed 1,000 men. The Bible tells in Judges chapter 15, verse 15 and 19, he did that. And then on another occasion, he just took the gates of a city and walked off with it. Now when Samson killed these 1,000 Philistines with a jawbone of a donkey, there he was so thirsty and had no water to drink till he looked in that jawbone he had in his hand, and there sprang up a little spring of water. And there the man of God drank from that little spring of water. God performed the miracle and brought water out of that jawbone of that donkey. Now he couldn't have drank that good water had he not obeyed God and defeated the Philistines. If you want to drink of the good fresh water of God, the good spirit of God, you must slay your Philistines. They're all around you. They were the enemies of Israel for years. And these old Philistines are your enemies. These temptations that comes from the devil, and he's behind the temptations. In order to drink from the jawbone in which you use against the devil, you must slay your enemy. And that's exactly what Samson did. On another occasion, he was tempted by the Philistines. And they said, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson, in Judges chapter 16, verse 3. And he just picked up the gates of the city and walked off with it up on top of the hill. Now that's what Jesus did in the matter of death, in robbing the grave, or in defeating the devil and death, hell, and the grave. That's exactly what the Son of God did. He just picked up the gates of the city, as it were, and walked up on top of the hill and says, it's finished, it's over. Death has no more sting for you. And then the Bible says the hair began to grow. Judges chapter 16, verse 22, howbeit the hair of his head began to grow. He had lost the 7 locks of his hair. Now I want you to turn, will you please, over to 2 Peter, and let's see what he lost. And let's see what you can lose if you don't move according to what God told Samson to do. Then you can very easily lose these things in your life. Now look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Whereby are given us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the pollution that's in the world through lust. So you're partaking today of the divine nature of God. And then God said, knowing that you have the Spirit of God in you, that has imparted unto you God's divine nature, he said to do something else. And to add, or give diligence unto, and beside this, give all diligence, add to your faith. See, you have faith in God, like a Sunday school teacher told you here this morning in the class, that faith in God. You might have faith in God when you receive Christ as your Savior. Faith can be hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And then you add to that virtue. Virtue, be a manly man and a womanly woman. Be a man, be a woman for God. Add virtue in many ways to that faith. That's the first lock. Lock number two, you add to that virtue knowledge. Don't sit around like a dumbbell. Learn all you can about God's Word and how to do the job for God. Search for knowledge. Read the book. Study. Show thyself approved unto God. That's lock number two. And then he said, add to knowledge temperance. You to be temperance in all things. That's not talking about just drinking alcohol. That's talking about anything that you can overdo. You can overdo your eating habits. Many of us do. We glut, we eat, and we're not temperate in many things. We need to be temperate in all things, the Bible tells us here. So we need to add to our knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience. During these hot summer months and days and weeks, and it's very easy to become impatient. A lot of people can snap someone up or say something unkind. I'll be very impatient because of the hot weather and the dry weather and things that come along. That's why you need a lot of patience and patience with one another. Somebody said a man should be as patient with his wife as would be sitting on a fish bank waiting for a fish to bite on the riverbank. Have you ever sat on the riverbank waiting for a fish to bite? While some of you sat there minutes and hours at a time. You should be that patient with your wife, someone said. And we all need patience one with another. We can be very impatient on the job, in the home, in the church. And we need to be careful how we snap and bite and devour one another. We need that patience. So you add some patience. That's another lock of his hair. And the patience, godliness. Be Christ-like. What would the Lord have me to do? Could I walk in the shoes he'd walk in today? Can I do what he would do today if he was walking in my shoes? Godliness, and then under godliness, kindness. It doesn't hurt anyone to be kind. That's another lock of Samson's hair there. You need to be kind. That doesn't hurt anybody. You walk around with a dour expression on your face and a splenetic attitude, and you expect somebody to smile at you when you look like you're just eating crab apples and drank a cup of vinegar. Well, you can't expect them to really smile too much at you. Now, if you'll smile, the world will smile with you. And if you meet someone that doesn't have a smile, give them one of yours and see what they do about that. We need a good, kind attitude and give some kindness, extend that kindness in our homes, to our wives, to our children, in the church, on the job, and not be an old grouch. Man came into church one time, he's an old grouch, and the pastor said, well, brother, said, did you leave your grouch at home this morning? He said, yeah, she hadn't got up when I left. Now, we need to realize that we don't need to bring grouch to church. Leave old grouch at home. And so try to be kind one toward another. And God will bless us. And then not only that, he said there should be kindness, and then there should be love. Love is the nexus of God's plan. God wants us to love each other. And if we love each other, John said, that proves we're Christians. Having love one toward another. This world loves its own. Anybody can love those that are kind toward them. But can we love those that's not kind toward us? That's another lock of Samson's hair. And if you lose these seven locks, like we find here in 2 Peter chapter 1, then you're going to be like Samson. Samson became blind. God said you can't see afar off if you lose these seven locks. And you soon forget that you were really saved back yonder somewhere. And you loved God at one time. Look at the verse 8. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you wear these seven locks, you're bound to bring forth fruit. If you allow these seven locks to be clipped from you by Satan, you're not going to produce any fruit. Now notice, but he that liketh these things is blind. Is that not what happened to Samson? He lost his seven locks of his hair and he became a blind man. The enemy of God came in, and his enemy, and gouged his eyes out. And that's what happens a lot of times to a lot of saved people. They allow the seven locks of their hair to be cut off. What I mentioned here in 2 Peter 1. And then they are blind and cannot see afar off. They are blinded to things that God wants them to see. And then they have forgotten, they have forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Poor old Samson forgot about how he was a Nazarite and he's purged from his old sins. A lot of church members like that today. Some sitting out there in the radio listening audience. You know that you need to be in God's house. You said you were saved back yonder some time ago. You allowed the devil to clip off the seven locks of your hair. You're sitting out there, forgot about that time when God saved you. And you might have been in hell had not God saved you. Well, one of these days, God may knock on your door. God has your number. And you can sit there with your seven locks missing, blinded, binding and grinding. That's exactly what happened to Samson. He was blinded and they bound him and he began to grind at the devil's gristmill. And Satan will cause you to be bound by the habits and evils of this world. And he will bind you to the evils of this world. And you will grind at the devil's gristmill, not realizing back yonder where God saved you, where you can be serving God. Now his hair began to grow. I'm glad that although you may let the devil clip your seven locks, you shouldn't. But if you do, I'll clip part of them. If you'll get low before God and be patient, obey the Lord, those seven locks will begin to grow out again. Are you happy in the Lord? Are you rejoicing? Are you witnessing? Are you doing for God what you did back yonder when you had the long seven locks? Or have your head been shaved? Have the devil clipped them off and you're not trying to witness anymore. You're not reading your Bible. You're not praying. You're not giving. You're not serving. You're not faithful. You're sitting around like a bunch of bald-headed monks and doing nothing for God. We need to realize that God will let our hair grow out if we're willing for it to grow out again. God's a good God, praise God. And God extends his mercy toward us. And if you let the Lord, God Almighty will let the seven locks of your hair grow out again. But if you don't let him do it, it's not going to grow out. You walk around bald-headed, butt one around like a bunch of billy goats. But God wants your hair to grow out and have the seven locks to the glory of God. And so you check up now, see if you got them. If you don't have them, then you need to get them to the glory of God. You've listened well, stand to your feet. Our Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and use it. We know that Samson lost his seven locks. But thank you, our Father, that they grew out again. And you allowed him, our Father, in his dying moments to accomplish more for thee than he did all of his lifetime, although he died in doing so. God, help us to serve thee and those that let their locks be shaven. Our God can still let the locks grow out and accomplish more for God until their dying day than they have in the past. Help us to realize that. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, Debbie's going to play for us. Now, listen to me. If you're in this building and you're unsaved, or if you're here backslidden, or if you're here and you want to join this church, or for any other reason you want to come forward, if you feel like the devil has shaved the locks of your hair off, then you want to come forward, ask God to give you patience and wisdom, and ask God, let him grow back. God, let him grow back. And while she's playing, would you come if God is speaking to you in any manner? How about it? Come if God is speaking. If you need to get saved, need to come back into fellowship with God, you want to join the church, want to rededicate your life, or for any reason, you alone know whether or not God's speaking to you. I brought the message God laid on my heart. It's up to you now to respond. She plays just another stanza. I feel somebody is holding back. Somebody needs to come forward. God is speaking to someone. Would you come? While we wait, would you come? Take an open stand for God. That's one of the best ways in the world to be strong and overcome the evil one is take that open stand for God and let the people know you're taking a stand for God and you want to serve the Lord. Come on now while we wait.